This is Billy Kay with the final episode of The Declaration, Programme 3, The Abbey of Arbroath.
The Abbey's been part of our life since the day I was born. I was born, I think, within the bounds of the Abbey.
Do people visit the Abbey because of the Declaration?
I think that is definitely one of the key draws, because obviously you might not have heard of Arbroath Abbey, but you've heard of the Declaration of Arbroath. It's the hook that draws people in.
It embodies the feelings of Scots, even those who need not necessarily think that Scotland should be independent. There is an independence of thinking that's in it that I think appeals to the majority of Scots.
I feel sorry for anyone who doesn't know the Abbey. I just feel it's part of our whole bones, and that's what we're all about. And as long as we're alive, we will tell people about it.
Even if there's just the two of us.
Not necessarily 100.
Children of the Abbey, brother and sister Tom and Anita Walker, and Dr. Nikki Scott of Historic Environment Scotland. I was there on a very special day when the nobles of Scotland, the bairns of Hayshead Primary School, were summoned to compose their own declaration by none other than Robert the Bruce himself.
Right, my lords and ladies, so we have talked about what we're going to do to inform the Pope of what's going on, because we think he has been misinformed. But if we're going to write him a letter, what do you think? What sort of things do you think we would put in there?
Try and convince him.
And you've got to write it in different writing, do you?
Yeah, what language were we writing it in?
Latin.
Latin, yeah.
I can't really write anything in Latin.
I'll tell you what we'll do. If we write ours in English, and then what I'll do,
Google Translate it.
It's Brother Google we'll use, one of the monks who will translate it all for us. And what we're going to do is we're going to give each a little section to write. Yeah, you want it to be big, powerful words so that the Pope's got, oh, I really want to read this letter.
Dear Almighty, most powerful, wonderful person. You're the most powerful, wonderful, amazing person I've ever heard of in my life. I think that's going to convince him.
He's probably never had a letter from Arbroath before, so you have to convince him to read this.
Yeah.
He is a good king and he is brave because he fought for his country. Robert is also a great leader and is very inspiring. And Robert also does a lot of good things for the country and the people of Scotland.
We would like to be an independent country so we can be free to do our own thing.
This is very powerful stuff. This is a letter from the people of Scotland. That's you. And he's got to recognise that.
Alistair Strachan there, presiding over a modern declaration. But to find out what happened to the ancient document itself, I met Dr. Alan Borthwick of National Records of Scotland at Register House in Edinburgh.
It is in rather a fragile state, and it does require to be in conditions which ensure that it is stable, and so therefore it is not really practical for us to bring it out on display, except on a very small number of occasions, one of which we certainly hope will be the 700th anniversary of its being written.
How important is it in your collection?
I think all my colleagues would say that it is the document which we think is the most important one that we have got in our holdings.
That sort of connection with the Declaration still resonates very strongly with people. When the Stone of Destiny was borrowed, shall we say, from Westminster in the 1950s, they chose the high altar here at Arbroath to deposit the stone, those who'd borrowed it.
They took it to Arbroath Abbey and covered it with a salt. There was a historic significance, the justification for Scotland being an independent kingdom was in the Declaration of Arbroath.
Fifteen weeks after it disappeared from Westminster Abbey, where for 650 years it formed part of the throne of coronation, the Stone of Scoon, which was wrenched from here on the night of Christmas Eve, has returned to the light of day. In Arbroath Abbey, close to the grave of William the Lion, who built the abbey, the stone was deposited by three men who remain unknown. Here, 631 years ago, the Declaration of Scottish Independence was signed.
The incident is commemorated in a display at the Abbey. Ian Hamilton was one of the students involved back in 1950.
We chose Arbroath because it was in Arbroath in 1320 that the Scottish nation affirmed its nationality again by sending a letter to the Pope, who was the United Nations of the time. And it contains these remarkable words. For we fight not for glory, not for riches, not for honours, but only and alone for freedom, which no good man gives up, but with life itself. And we thought that Arbroath, with these words in our ears, was the appropriate place to deliver the stone of destiny up to the Scottish nation.
The Abbey is the beginning and core of Arbroath, and many say the famous letter of Arbroath encapsulates the core and the driving force of the people of Scotland. Our past heroes have acted. We in our own time must act too. But we are not alone. We are fortified and moulded by the heroes of the past. We are not one person. We are a multitude. We are the Scots. Our victory is assured.
Jim McGugan is one of a group of local nationalists who gather on April 6th to commemorate those who fought for their cause, past and present.
Wendy Wood, Oliver Brown, Jock Hay, Dalgety Castle.
Well, I keep it going because the torch has been passed on to me and others who support us. But we know that this took place in the 1930s and that heroes have taken part in this ceremony for many years, and we like to keep it going.
I had the privilege sometime in the 60s to be chosen by the Arbroath Abbey pageant to be King of Scots. This was a turning moment, if you like, in my life, because at dress rehearsals, as I sat there with Frank Thornton on the battlements proclaiming the declaration, I was furious. I was 26, and these words had only come to my ears after 26 years. I was so angry, I went straight out and joined a particular political party who are dedicated to the restoration of Scottish independence.
Jim McGugan became so enthused that he brought along a Scots Independent paper, and Frank Thornton went ballistic. Now, Frank was a great nationalist, but he would not have this. This is totally non-political.
I was at practically every performance, and irrespective of when it was, the hairs went up on the back of my neck.
There was one particular night that a ground mist came in, mm-hmm. and people were appearing out of the mist.
Yet Robert himself, should he turn aside from the task that he has begun and yield Scotland or us to the English king and people, we should cast out as the enemy of us all, a subverter of our rights and of his own, and choose another king to defend our freedom.
The 650th celebration pageant ended. We introduced the two knights who were known to have taken this declaration to the Pope in Avignon. They left down the nave carrying the declaration in its casket and out the door, and they were heard riding off into the night. As they rode off, the lights were dimmed. A monk appeared with a torch and climbed up the passages above the round O and lit a brazier in that window. The brazier was lit and the light of independence went over Scotland and the world.
An archive clip of the pageant in 1947 with Frank Thornton declaiming the declaration. As the 650th anniversary approached, the political establishment realised they had to commemorate the occasion, although they worried about it adding to a nationalist surge. Jim Lynch was on an SNP march to the official ceremony presided over by Secretary of State for Scotland, Willie Ross. The marchers and the participants were heckled by Protestant loyalists led by Pastor Jack Glass, Murray Pittock of Glasgow University, on the political background in 1970.
It's the subject of a stamp in 1970. Rather less respectably, the 1320 Club is founded on the right of the SNP in 1968. And it's in that period, the period of the first wave of Scottish nationalism from the victory at Hamilton to the 1970 general election. Probably the Royal Mail agreed to put the Declaration of Arbroath on one of the historic stamps because of that upsurge.
As we walked through the streets of Arbroath, I was astounded when Pastor Jack Glass and his 20th century Reformation union shouting at us, "What are you doing here? Celtic's not playing here today," that kind of thing. And we got up to the Abbey grounds and they had the reading of the Declaration. But while the Declaration was being read, Pastor Glass and his crew stood along the back shouting, "No popery, no popery." And then Arthur Donaldson went up to the policeman in charge and he said, "Will you move these people or will he?" So the police moved them.
Why were they there? Would it be because it was a letter to the Pope?
Oh, aye. Anything to do with the Pope was...
Can you imagine what a unionist event that had to be? Because there couldn't possibly be any expression of nationalism at it. And so Willie Ross read the lesson. Absolute chance, I happened to be sitting next to Wendy Wood. And she sat there, and in the midst of his address, she stood up and said the single word, "Hypocrite." Sat down, Special Branch turned around, having seen an old customer, but they then left her alone. But it was embarrassing to see the Declaration of Arbroath celebrated through Unionist eyes. The whole thing was an establishment enterprise that day, relieved only at the end by the appearance of the Countess of Errol, High Constable in Scotland, and incidentally a leading nationalist herself. Countess of Errol stepped forward, and Scots Wha Hae was played. The only time I've ever heard it played as our national anthem.
Journalist Gordon Casely, recalling the 1970 celebration. Another amazing occasion featuring the Declaration took place at Oxford University. Corey Gibson of Glasgow University.
The Oxford Union debate in November 1964 was on the motion, "Extremism in defence of liberty is no vice, moderation in the pursuit of justice is no virtue." And that's a quotation from Barry Goldwater, who was the Republican candidate for the presidency of that year. But speaking for his motion were Hugh MacDiarmid, Scottish nationalist, a pretty idiosyncratic kind of communist, and Malcolm X, black nationalist, member of the Nation of Islam, but latterly beginning to develop his ideas in all sorts of international and anti-capitalist and anti-colonial kind of ways. And this took place just three, four months before he was assassinated. So the historical moment it represents and the setting, it just seemed a wild meeting of minds.
"There are far too few extremists, far too immense a mass of conformist, unthinking, and indeed moronic people, like a millstone round the neck of all progress."
He sets up his mention of the Declaration of Arbroath in this like patchwork of quotations from all over the place by suggesting that there have been great historical statements that describe the degree of commitment necessary to pursue these high ideals of justice and liberty.
"I know no national liberation movement that has been won without a terrible struggle, without civil disobedience, violence, war, or civil war. No great national movement was ever founded on caution and half-hearted measures. I'm a Scotsman, as you can hear. In the Declaration of Arbroath, away back in 1320, perhaps the greatest democratic pledge of all time, my people, the Scottish people, swore that as long as 100 of them remained alive, they would never allow themselves to be dominated by the English." "For so long as 100 of us remain alive, we shall never, under any conditions, submit to the domination of the English. It is not for glory, or riches, or honors that we fight, but only for liberty, which no good man will consent to lose but with his life. My people have done little but betray that ever since."
he does allude to, quote, revolutions which have changed the balance of world power and of ongoing national liberation movements on three continents. So both he and Malcolm X sense that an established world order is crumbling in this period in the post-colonial era.
Well, any time you live in a society supposedly based upon law, and it doesn't enforce its own law because the color of a man's skin happens to be wrong, then I say those people are justified to resort to any means necessary to bring about justice where the government can't give them justice.
So come on, ye, at him we freedom, never heed what the hoodies croak for doom. And your hoosh, the bairns o' Adam, can't find breed while he'd be in painted room. When MacLean meets sweet friends and spring one, all the roses and gains will turn to bloom. And a black boy free on Nyanga dings the fell gallows o' the burghers doon.
Hamish Henderson's The Freedom Come All Ye was written just 2 or 3 years before the events we've been talking about, the Oxford Union. And so it does reference very directly anti-apartheid struggles in South Africa. It imagines a hopeful future Scotland that has somehow cleaned its hands of the bloody empire and envisage an egalitarian and a kind of post-racial future. Although it does touch on collective ideas of freedom and sovereignty, like perhaps the Declaration of Arbroath.
The idea is there's a continuity of Scottish nationalism all the way from 1320 to today. And then people say, well, no, there isn't. And people say, yes, there is. And I think the right answer is a bit of this and a bit of that. Yes, but not as quite as we know it now.
Here's to the men who took the oath, the Declaration of Arbroath. Freedom and right, our cause is both, no English subjugation, goes a popular nationalist song from the period. Another factor leading to greater awareness was the publication of facsimile copies. The Burns Federation, for example, presented an engraving, text and translation of it to every secondary school and teachers' training college in 1949. And the Scottish Records Office published a facsimile for the 650th anniversary. It was now conspicuous and instantly recognisable.
And what's that over there? Asked Pat, pointing to a large framed document hanging on the wall above the espresso machine. Oh, the Declaration of Arbroath, said Lou. Pat peered at the framed picture of the ancient document with its line of dangling seals. For a few moments, she was transported back to a warm classroom at school on a summer day some years ago, 10, possibly a dozen, when her teacher, Miss Fraser, cruelly called Miss Frazzle, which children are not innately cruel when they sense adult vulnerability, taught them about that crucial moment in Scottish history. The Scots were in despair over the depredations of the English, she intoned, and who would not be in the circumstances? Our nobles and unfortunately girls, we cannot be unduly proud of them, scheming and malodorous lot they were, nonetheless spoke from the heart when they signed this letter to Pope John the 22nd, luxuriating away in his distant Vatican. I'm Alexander McCall Smith. I'm a writer. I've written a number of books set in Edinburgh, and this excerpt is from one of the Scotland Street novels in which two of the characters are having a discussion about a copy of the Declaration of Arbroath that Pat sees in Big Lou's coffee bar. Big Lou was watching Pat and wondering what she was thinking. Was she trying to remember exactly what the Declaration of Arbroath was? Was it possible that nobody taught anybody about it anymore? Was it possible that Scottish history was being ignored by a nation that was encouraged to forget who it was and where it had come from? They wrote to the Pope, she began. I know, Pat reassured her. I don't suppose he received many letters from Arbroath. Big Lou continued, when I was at school, we learned the words off by heart. I could recite it from start to finish. I was 11. Pat looked at her and smiled. I knew a boy who could recite Tam O'Shanter word perfect when he was 8. Big Lou nodded. There used to be lots of boys like that, she said. But still, do you remember this bit? She pointed to a section of the Declaration. May it please you to admonish and exhort the King of the English, who ought to be satisfied with what belongs to him, to leave us Scots in peace, who live in this poor little Scotland, beyond which there is no dwelling place at all, and covet nothing but our own. Pat nodded. I remember that.
My granddad was a great enthusiast for the Declaration. He was also a dyed-in-the-wool communist who saw in the Declaration all sorts of fundamental assertions of rights and of liberties denied that he responded to. He'd be reading the Morning Star and would move seamlessly from that to discuss all sorts of aspects of Scottish history. That feeling of brotherhood, yes. That feeling of causes that didn't depend on high leadership. That's why the deposition clause was particularly interesting to him, I think. And the entire thing about the very famous line, for as long as 100 of us remain alive, I think it appealed to his throne nature and his attachment to communism in an era which didn't really appreciate it as a benign attachment. I still have this emotional reaction to it, but it's an emotional reaction that takes me back to Beveridge Street and Dunfermline rather than Arbroath in 1320.
Given at the Monastery of Arbroath in Scotland on the 6th day of the month of April in the year of grace 1320.
Arbroath Abbey does have something very special about it. Something of that feeling you get at Iona Abbey, just that sort of slight feeling of otherworldliness almost, just that little something extra that's very difficult to articulate, but you feel when you're here. Generation upon generation of people have considered this place to be important, and there's somehow still that sense of that remaining within the fabric of the walls. And to be here and be surrounded by that, you just sort of embody that and add back to that feeling, so subsequent generations can perhaps also feel it.
No, it's imbued with something.
Yes, definitely. That's a good word.
Nicky Scott and Steve Boardman of Edinburgh University. In more recent times, there's been a definite shift in the way different sections of society perceive the period that produced the Declaration. Alexander Brodie of Glasgow and Roger Mason of St Andrews University.
Seemed to be relatively easy for 19th, early 20th century Scottish intellectuals, people generally, to accommodate veneration of Bruce and Wallace within a broader unionist framework. But things have clearly changed in the late 20th century. The greater purchase that notions of independence and a separate Scottish identity have had are clearly changing people's attitude to these iconic people and documents.
I don't think recognising the Declaration of Arbroath for what it is, this great heartfelt plea, doesn't necessarily mean that one goes down any particular political road. Obviously, it's a very, very powerful declaration in that sense, but it's a declaration for all people.
It's championed by people who want to see an independent Scotland, and it's rubbished or minimised by people who don't. So I think the Declaration suffers today. It's got a high profile because it seems to be a pro-independence document, and I think, frankly, it is a pro-independence document. Very hard to see there's anything else. But at the same time, it suffers because there's this huge division in today's Scotland along the lines of nationalism and unionism.
Does it still have resonance today?
I think it does, but there have been times when the star of this idea has been bright, and there have been times when it's dim. And indeed, I would say that today it's exceptionally bright.
But I do wonder if the main message tends to be forgotten, which is a very obvious message. It's about Scotland as an independent kingdom in a Europe of independent kingdoms. That is what it's all about. As a powerful statement with eventually a European reputation of a kingdom's independence within a Europe of kingdoms, you don't need much imagination to see how that resonates today.
One of our greatest historians, Geoffrey Barrow, described the legacy of Bruce and the Declaration as satisfying a deep yearning shared by people in Scotland and Scots the world over for an identity and a history which it seems, to me at least, inhumane, unjust and unwise to deny them. I'll leave the last words on this magnificent document to Fiona Watson, Dovet Brune, Murray Pittock, and to Ian Forrester, the UK's last judge in the General Court of the European Union.
It's a first in constitutional terms. The Declaration of Arbroath is an intriguing assertion of the distinctiveness of a national people. The Scottish Declaration is one of a number of constitutional documents which, when the history is written of the creation of a peaceful European continent, will be among the relevant sources.
Do you think there is a Scottish tradition in Europe?
There is a very strong recognition inside the European institutions and inside the court about the separate identity of Scotland. I remember shortly after the referendum vote, one of the ushers in the court very solemnly came up to me and said, "I want to say how sorry we are about the outcome of the referendum vote. Notre espoir, c'est l'Écosse. Our hope is Scotland."
There is an interesting and important story to tell about all sorts of things through the Declaration of Arbroath. Fiona Watson had a wonderful idea of just saying, well, let's make this a celebration of freedom. So there are ways in which it can be depoliticised and still celebrated. But there is also, and let's be frank and fair about this, it is a political document. And it should remind people of what cannot be denied, which is that Scotland was an independent kingdom, and there was a moment in its history where that had to be asserted.
It does stir the hearts of Scots and folks well beyond Scotland. And that makes me intensely proud that we've produced this document, and it frustrates me somewhat that it's not better known. It is the earliest document coming out of medieval Europe to argue for self-determination of any nation. It should be something that we Scots shout to the world about, as long as we understand that it's not simple, because it never is.
As long as people do not get educated with the history of Scotland and the literature and culture of Scotland as part of their normal, full-scale curriculum through primary and secondary school, as a matter of course, then people will always think of their history as something they don't quite own. And Scotland should own the Declaration. We need to normalise our own history.